our hearts were full of joy today that we have the opportunity to be alive and in a frame of mind where we can come to the house of God and praise God. May God accept our thanks. So before we go to pray, we still have just about an hour before we go to pray, or 30 minutes or so, because I want you to spend some time in prayer. But as you know, the word of God will help your prayer. The word of God will help your prayer. So let's go into the word of God to see how we can cross over to our land of promise. So how do we cross over to our land or our life of promise? The Israelite land of promise is our life of promise. Just as God promised the children of Israel the land of Canaan by oath, by covenant, He has also promised us an abundant life through by oath, by covenant, through the blood of Jesus Christ. So, we start from Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. That's where we find our key verse from. And we pass over to the year 2020 and to a new decade. Next year, the beginning of a new decade. I trust that that decade is going to be a wonderful decade for you. We have a pen and pencil, you want them to write down and look at them again. In Joshua chapter 1, this book of the Lord shall not depart out of thy mouth, for thou shalt meditate them day and night, that thou mayest prosper, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So as we move into the new decade, the new year of our life, it's important for us to know that this is the key to success. This is the key to happiness. This is the key to being rapture ready when the Lord shall come. But it's good for us to read Joshua chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. Let's read Joshua chapter 3, verses 1 to 17, because we're going to use that one as our object lesson, how the children of Israel were able to crush from the land of enough to the land of more than enough. You will recall that when the children of Israel was in Egypt, Egypt was a land of not enough. But when they got over into the wilderness, it was a land of just enough. But when they get to Canaan, it was a land of more than enough. And year 2020 and the decade that is coming is going to be a decade of more than enough for you. That is, you have more than enough to eat, you have more than enough to pay your rent, you have more than enough to buy what you need, you have more than enough to take care of yourself and your family. Amen. So this coming decade is a decade of more than enough in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Because He is able to provide more abundantly. In the wilderness, there was no event. investment, there was no need to invest in anything at all. Because if you take mana, you keep it, it gets stuck. It gets spoiled. So it's a life of no investment. It's a life where they just live from hand to mouth. And God is saying that He's moving you to a new life of more than enough. You're going to drink of the well you didn't drink. You're going to eat of the grape you didn't plant. It didn't mean that you have for free. But things are already provided for you to take care of. So they had an obstacle, and that obstacle was River Jordan. How are they going to cross River Jordan? They crossed River Jordan by faith. And I'm telling you, you are crossing over to your land or your life of more than enough by faith. By obedience, by hearkening to the word of God, you will be able to cross from the life of just enough to your life of more than enough. So, the objective of our discussion is about 5 points. That is, you must prepare to move into your promised life. There's a preparation for you to make to move into your promised life of more than enough. And you must realize that holiness is the key to possessing and retaining your life. It's good to be saved, but it is better to be able to retain your salvation. And holiness is very critical for you to possess and retain your life of promise. You will also know that the word of God will be a lamp and a light to your path. You wouldn't travel far without the word of God before you know you can go far. Because if you are saved by the word of God, you have to be led by the word of God also. For the word of God has saved you will provide way for you when you get to the junction of decision in your life. You also notice that consecration is critical when you are crossing over and meaning over. When you are crossing over to Canaan and you're living in Canaan, consecration is essential. There are people who have crossed from sin to Christian life and yet they can't keep their salvation because it's been consecrated. Then we consider that obedience is a bridge that it connects you to where you are now, to where God wants you to be. My brothers and sisters, God has a better plan for you, a better life for you, a wonderful life for you, but the bridge between where you are and to where God wants you to be is obedience. That is why that song that says, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So in Joshua chapter 3, where we read, continue from verse 2. And it came to pass after 3 days that the officers went through the host, 3, and they commanded the people, saying, when you see the ark of covenant of the Lord your God, and the priest and the Levite bearing it, then ye shall move from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2 cubits by a measure. Come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way before. And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. So we see therefore that there's an appointed day for the crossover. You know, our time is in God's hand. There are many things we have control over, there's many things we don't have control over. You don't have control over time. We're going to talk about GPS GPS today. That is the God's standard time, GST. We're going to talk about GST, God's standard time, not GMT or CAT. You know, in Australia now they're already in the new year. New Zealand, they're first to be in the new year. Hong Kong, they're in the new year. So there's a 10-year time when we play one place of God together. But for God, there is God standard time. See, let me hear. God standard time. Again, God standard time. God has a standard time to move from where you are to where he wants you to be. And when you are a child of God and you are able to listen to him, you will be able to hear, he said, move. as a trained soldier, you just move. You got to move when the commander moves. So, there's an appointed day for all of us, and it's time for everything. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. There's a time for everything. Do not think you always have the time. You don't have the time, you only have your life. There's time for everything. In verse 1 to everything, there's a time, a season, and a time for every purpose under heaven. Therefore, you need to watch for the movement of the Spirit of God. Because the Spirit of God will prompt you to change your position. The Spirit of God will prompt you to change your consecration, to improve it. The Spirit of God will change things to tell you to move to your own bear. Because all of us, we have got our own bear. You know the meaning of that. When he was farming in the land, God told Elijah to go to the brook. That was his own bear. It is there that God provided for him. Say amen. Amen. And when the brook dried, there was another bear. He said he should move to the widow's house. That was his bear. But ultimately, now he has been provided for him in the widow's house. That was his own bear. Amen. And when it was time to go to Mount Carmel, he went to Mount Carmel, and the prayer was, and the fire came down. That was his own there. Amen. But when he ran away, it was not his own there. He couldn't get what was the best. You know? So we are praying that God will keep us sensitive, so that when God says go, we go. Because he has the time that will help us to get into our own there, to move into our own life of promise. And then know that wasted life is the time wasted is opportunity or life wasted. Time wasted is opportunity or life wasted. If you read in Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 20, you know, that is very unfortunate. They said, the harvest is past and yet you are not saved. And there are so many people in that condition, year in, year out. They are not saved. And yet the preacher has preached and you are not saved. We don't want us to be like that. In Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 20, God was lamenting when they said, in verse 20, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and yet you are not saved. That should not be your experience. We want to make sure that you do the right thing at the right time. And then we should also take note that there is most conscious of time of our divine visitation and God will help us. As we said earlier, they are going to move now from the life of just enough to the life of more than enough. And the first thing is a passport to the promised land. What was their passport to the promised land? Their passport to the promised land was to be member of the seed of Abraham. It is those who are members of the seed of Abraham who are qualified to go to the land that was covenanted to Abraham. That land of promise was given to Abraham not by sword, not by power, not by conquest, but by God's covenant. Amen. And your own promised life, amen, your own better life, amen, is given to you not by your education,
yes,
not by your certificate, not by your birthright, not by your father, not by your mother. I said, God has a life for you that your education cannot give.
Amen.
That your connection work cannot give.
Yes.
It is given by covenant. Amen.
Amen.
So, the passport to the promised life is you to be able to be grafted in the divine. In Galatians chapter 3, we are going to read later on. For you to be the seed of Abraham. And how do you become the seed of Abraham? You become the seed of Abraham first of all by being born again.
Amen.
John chapter 3, verse 3. He said, very, very, I say unto you, ye must be born again. You must be born again. It is when you are born again, you become the son of Abraham, the seed of Abraham, that you are qualified to move from the land of not enough across the wilderness of just enough into the superabundance of more than enough. Salvation is your passport. And holiness is your daily validity. It keeps you valid there. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, it says, follow peace with all men and holiness, with that which no man shall see the Lord. For you to retain the life that God is going to give you, you need to live a holy life, because holy life maintains you in the land, in the life that God has promised for you. And you have to surrender absolutely to the will of God and make sure you live a life fully dedicated to the will of God. So, these are very indispensable, as you can see, as we move to the life that God has promised for us. So, we have a life that is filled with milk and honey. Who wants to go to that life that is filled with milk and honey? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, so let's therefore continue as we manage to go ahead, as we move into our land of more than enough. You know, in Joshua, where we're in Joshua chapter 3, it was just, the timing was very critical. You notice here now that they did not control the time on their own. They have to move at the command of their commander-in-chief. Pregnant woman who was about to give birth must move. Say amen.
Amen.
And we are told there was nobody sick among them. But if there was anybody, it must move. Small children must move. When they saw the ark moving, everybody must just move in a uniform formation. Glory be to God for that.
Amen.
So we notice here that for us to move from our land of just enough to the land of more, a land of more than enough, we have to manage our life. What they call time management is actually self or life management. You can't manage time, you can only manage yourself. Because you are not the origin of it. When the time is, look at the time now, I can ask company, okay, stop. I'm not going to say, stop. No. You understand me? You can't stop it. But I can stop myself from doing wrong things. So, time management is actually life management. Say, let me hear. Time management is life management. Again.
Time management is life management.
So, if you have to manage yourself, you find that time is not a slave. It appears if the time is too much for what you want to do, but it's when you cannot manage yourself, you are doing what you are not supposed to do. Ah, that is right, that is right. I'm going, it's the same speed. The sense it doesn't change. It is you who is up. But when you adopt God's standard with time, you will find that your life will be better. Amen. GST is God's standard time. And it helps you to manage your life. So there's a type of divine meditation. And therefore we pray that God will help us not to miss our time of divine visitation. In John chapter 4 verse 7, we see that the woman at the well was going to fetch water at the right time. That was the time of divine visitation. I'm going to give you about two examples of those who did not miss their own time of divine visitation. One of them is this, the Samaritan woman. She was a public harlot, but who was thirsty of the right thing. And Jesus therefore had to wait at the well for her. And as she came, that was a divine timing. And she made use of that. And so Jesus was able to move her from the life of not enough to the life of more than enough. She was moved from the life of public dog to the life of public evangelist. The same thing God can do for us. He can do it for us. If we synchronize our time with God's time. Rebecca also in Genesis chapter 24, verses 12 to 20, which I'm not going to read, but you can refer to it. Genesis chapter 24, verses 12 to 20. And Isaac, the child of promise, needs the wife that is compliant with the child of promise. And God was going to do it. And Abraham said, go, my God, go with you. And God went with Eliezer, isn't it? And Eliezer said, I stand here. The comes, and I said, give me water to drink. And he said, I will give water to drink, and I will give you your cattle. Let her be the person. Because of that, she didn't say, let her be beautiful. Let her be red. Let her be gris. Let her be fat. Let her have 10 cats. Let her have 10 houses. Is that what she said? Because of women who want to marry, oh God, let her have 10 cats. Let her have a sister. No houses. That is what they are going for. He was praying for somebody who will go a second mile to do what is inconvenient. So, that is another day. We can see now that Rebecca also, you know, did not miss her time or did not appointment. As far as she came, Elijah said, give me water to drink. Oh yes, I will give water to drink. I even give you a camel. Then he said, one camel can drink about 10 gallons. And this, that was how she, at the right time, I'm praying in the name of Jesus that you will not miss your time of divine visitation.
Amen.
And you notice here that time of divine visitation is connected to doing the right thing at the right time. The woman at the well went to fetch water. You never see God helping a person who is lazy, who is still doing nothing. Moses was caught when he was busy with the sheep of his in-law in a burning bush. David was caught when he was busy with sheep by the hillside. This woman, by the way, met her destiny when she went to fetch water from the house bush. Rebecca also met her wife and her destiny when she was busy doing the right thing. I pray that God will help you not to be lazy. For you to move into the abundant kind that God has promised, you must cultivate the habit of walking with your hands instead of slipping away. There's something you can do. If you don't get government job, create a job for yourself. Humble yourself. In that humble position, you will get a divine visitation that will take you into your life of more than enough.
Amen.
So, you want to go to a life of superabundance? Please get up and manage yourself. Now, we see in where we have read is that God told the children of Israel that they are going to carry an instrument, and this instrument was an ark. The ark was the instrument that will help them to move across the obstacle of life. And this ark of God is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
The ark of God is what? It's the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The gospel is the vehicle for your possession. It's the vehicle that will carry you from the land of not enough. The land where you are not satisfied. The land where you are always sorrowful. The land where you are not happy. The land of super abundance, where you are happy. You are more than enough. It is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. This gospel has everything that you need.
Amen.
You don't need a prophet again. You don't need another pastor to dominate your life. The word of God will dominate your life. This old time religion is an act of salvation. Amen.
Amen.
It is old, but it is new. It's powerful. It is active. It can help you. See, the gospel cannot fail to deliver you across your reach. No. I don't know what you are suffering from. I don't know the challenges you are facing. I know you are on one side now. You want to move to a new life. I said the gospel is the bridge. The gospel will move you across.
Amen.
Amen. Try it. And you will see when you are faithful in embracing the sound doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ, it will carry you across safely.
Amen.
So, why is that so? Why is it so? Because Jesus Christ, the light of the world, is inside the ark. Amen. He is the ark himself. Amen. And the Spirit of God is guide. John chapter 16. The Spirit of God will guide you to all truth. Say all truth.
All truth.
All truth.
All He began into all truth.
That's the spirit of God.
What are the angels of God? The angels of God are assignment. And you have heard over and over again that the angels of God are the executive arm of God's omnipotence. He just wants to speak the word and the kind of God was spoken by you. It's just like the judge. The judge said, you are going to jail. He has spoken that one on behalf of the whole nation, isn't it? You must go to jail. It doesn't matter who you are. When the judge speaks, you are going to jail. The policeman will carry you now, they will put handcuffs in you. It doesn't matter who you are yesterday. What the judge says, you are going to jail, they will handcuff you. Because once he speaks, there is an executive act that was any other authoritative, mandated, word. So also at the angels of God, you have a guiding angel, and you have others that surround you. So when you belong to this gospel, you've got nothing to fear. It will carry you from your land of just enough to the land of life of more than enough. And of course, you are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. Look, it's wonderful to belong to this gospel. You see, one young man is struggling, God is helping him. He's a cloud of witness, isn't it? And that person has no job but is not stealing. It's a kind of witness. You hear of testimony from other people. You know that everybody is going through the same challenges and God, the same God is helping them. So that's why we say the gospel is the vehicle to carry you from where you are to where God wants you to be. Not the opinion of men. Not the philosophy of men. So may God help us. Now, so we look at it now. If the gospel is the vehicle to carry us from across to our land of superabundance, what is that ark? We find that the first thing we can talk about in that ark is the word of God. Because the ark contains the table, the two tables of commandment, is the word of God. And the Bible says in Psalm 1 verse 105, thy word abide in my heart that I will not sin against thee. Let's read Psalm 119 verse 105. Thy word is a lamp, thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Psalm 119 verse 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. In touch of medium term and long distance guidance. It talks of short range, which is the lamp, and the light, the path, is the long range. Strategic direction. That is the path. The path is a strategic direction. The word of God will give life in a strategic direction. And the lamp is for immediate guidance. The lamp is for immediate faith to be with the human guidance. That is the word of God. That is why this gospel, where the sound of his speech, will provide you strategic and the short-term direction. By the time you begin to embrace the word and you meditate upon it day and night, you will not be short of direction. Before you get to the junction of decision, you will hear a voice that asks you, this is the way. Amen. And in Psalm 19, verse 7 to 9, this word of God, which is contained in the gospel, any church that does not preach the word is not a church, it's just a society. Psalm 19, I read verses 7 to 11. Psalm 19, verse 7. The law of God is perfect. The law of the Lord is the word of God. Converting soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure. Making wise is simple. The statutes of the Lord are right. The justice in the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure. Enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean. Enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are pure and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold. Yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than money. And moreover, verse 11, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Amen. So in the ark, which
prepared a way for them across Jordan. And we said, this ark is the commandment. Now is the word of God. And the word of God in your heart prepared a way for you.
Amen.
Amen. And that's why in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17, Ephesians chapter 6, take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So you can see this word of God is not only for defensive and the direction providing mechanism, but also for offensive mechanism. How much do you love the word of God? By the time you begin to complain so much, I wonder how much the word you have heard. By the time you think in your life is being controlled by somebody, it means you don't submit to the word of God. By the time somebody has done something, you say, oh, I cannot be happy. I think you are wrong. Your happiness is not in anybody's hand.
Yeah.
Your prosperity is not in anybody's hand.
Right.
Your future is not in anybody's hand. Yeah. It's not in the hand of your father, your mother, your husband, your wife. Your prosperity is in the hand of God.
Yeah.
He said, woe unto you that trust in man and let man his hand. You will not even know when God is calling you.
You will not be that guy, that man, in that person, that is causing me.
Lord is for you. Who can be against you and survive? It's impossible. I want to advise us that as we gather a momentum to cross over to a better life, a better decade of more than enough, let us put the word of God in the right position. Meditate upon it day and night. The light will make a world of difference. In the years to come, you will know the importance of what I'm saying. Because there's no how good a person is, he has his offside time. There's no how wise a person is, sometimes there's something that is wrong. But the word of God is never wrong. Heaven and earth will pass away, the word of God will never pass away. You can trust what the Bible says. Anytime, all the time. So, and you understand that you overcome him. Oh, amen, amen. Alright, so, that's it now. And then also in the ark, we have an instrument which is also very popular, which is very important. That was the rod of the manna that he ate for 40 years. No, the manna that was kept in the ark was wonderful. During when you were in the wilderness, it is daily provision. You eat the manna today, if you kill it tomorrow, it will become bad. But across Sabbath, it should not be bad. But God said they should keep a pot of manna in the ark, and over the years, it didn't spoil. That is the miracle working power of God.
Amen.
And I'm saying that the same God will move you.
Amen.
A things that have failed with men, we succeed with you. Business that has they have failed, you will succeed. Think you places that at this cause I can't pass, you will become an agent. Because with God, all things are possible. God changes, God is the variable that changes the equation.
Yes.
If I use the mathematical language. God is the variable that does what? Changes the equation. If God is not in the equation, it is not solvable.
Right.
But when God is in, there is a variable in your equation, it becomes a simple linear equation.
Yes.
Very easy to solve.
Yes.
And may God help us.
Yes.
And surely will help us.
Yes.
So, that is the manna. And they kept the manna there. Why did they have to keep the manna? The manna is for the members. His testimony is Psalm 103. Psalm 103 verses 1 to 3. I said the gospel gives you testimony.
Yes.
Testimony that will help you in your downtime. Do you use that strategy at all when the devil box you into a corner? Do you learn to count your blessings? Or you begin to worry about what you don't have? In Psalm 103, he said, bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Yeah.
And he started to count. why he should bless the Lord. He said, who from the past he forgiven all thy iniquities, who forgiven all thy diseases.
Yeah.
When you meditate upon the word of God, your eyes will be open. He said, he forgive all.
Yeah.
Say all.
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 All. All.
If you are saved, how many sins has God forgiven you?
All.
Again.
All.
But many times, they will remind you that part of this one. What do you tell him? All. Again.
All. All.
Say, he forgive all. He remember all before we can say, you are the one that knows about the living. I hope you know. The sin that God has forgiven you, you can't remember it anymore.
Amen.
But then doesn't forget. Okay, I think you're saying don't forget. I will remind you. Then remind you that God hasn't gotten this to forgive that anymore. Say all. Who forgiven all the iniquities, who forgiven all the diseases. And who knows when he was writing this, maybe his leg was failing. Say, God has healed me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Because it is by promise, not by performance.
Yeah.
What God does for us is not by performance.
Amen.
It's by promise, it's a covenant. Okay, God opens your eyes to see that where God is moving you across Jordan, not by performance, but by covenant, you begin to feel inferior to the promise of God. And if God wants to do something wonderful, something that will surprise you. So, the matter was to remind them of God. Do you find time to praise God alone? If the devil reminds me of something bad, I will tell him two good things. If he didn't go away, I multiply by two, I tell him four good things. Does it work? It works. Try it. Amen. Okay, I hope you know I'm married. You know I'm married, my wife is here. Let me let the cat out of the bag. Sometimes, when she does something that offends me, sometimes you want to fight. I say, that's what you can tell me. Then I tell you two things. This is why this woman is very good. Then you will tell us, then I modify by two. Four things. Then you just go and look at them. Say amen.
Amen.
That is for you. Can you say that? Or can you put that one for your wife or your husband? Every time you tell him, it's bad, it's bad, it's bad. And when he says it's bad, he multiplies. So when the devil is telling you, giving you, is reminding you of what God has not done, what should you tell him? You tell him two things of what God has done. Do you get that?
Yes.
There's one thing that you miss. What should you tell him?
Two things.
Two things that you have already. That is why you overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony. When you have balance of terror, it tells you like nobody's in dominion. I am the priest of God, I am the priest, I am the king. This will help you in your life. Don't allow the devil to box into your corner to tell you that your life is on the other side of the equation. So no, God has moved me across and get him to. If he's very strong, then he will be ready for it. Next time, you will think twice before he comes to you.
Amen.
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 Glory to God. So, testimony therefore is very important. It's part of the gospel. He was planned to give you a testimony in the midst of the children of God so that you can give the right testimony in your place of work. When we see that your testimony must begin with salvation, is that people's testimony is about things of the world. I bought a car, I got a cell phone, I got a button. And my girlfriend said this one, that is not the testimony I'm looking for. The devil that will transform by that will minister grace to the hearers. That's the testimony we're looking for. And I trust God will give you that testimony.
Amen.
I didn't hear amen.
Amen.
So, grant your testimonies, you lift them one by one, and make the joy of the Lord to be your strength all the time. Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 and 6. So, in this gospel Bible, in this gospel trade, testimony is a weapon that you must use. And give testimony to yourself from time to time. Particularly when you're downcast, just take a walk. All the time is telling them what God has done for me. Say, I look at it and say, oh, it's wonderful. Ah, my, this is what God has done. And we have told you before, and it is because some people who are not there. What is the difference between the prayer you pray on your knee and the prayer you pray when you are walking? Is there any difference? Whom do you pray to? The same God. So what you say on your knee is as important as what you say when you are outside. That's why some people, you know, the prayer they pray on their knee, they negate it as well they get out of the church. There's no difference because everything is prayed to God. God hears them. When you pray, oh, Jesus, he's done it. Amen. He's done it. And then you start crying. I don't think it's possible. Which one do you want God to do now? So, your testimony is very, very important. In the ark also, we have the role of Aaron that bore it. You remember where there was the sun? When was in this church, in the camp, God said, the rod that bonded, let that person be the appointed person. It was the rod that carried that bonded. Overnight, it produced almond. And then God told him, pick it back, put it in the ark. It's in the ark. Why? To show that discipline, spiritual discipline is important for crossover. Say, let me hear. For you to be able to possess a life that is more than enough, for you to be able to retain a life that is more than enough, you must have a spiritual discipline. Because self-discipline is the best discipline. If you cannot discipline yourself, you have no right to discipline anybody. You have no right. You can't wake up in the morning, you are abusing your son and your child. Wake up, go to school, and now you are sleeping to 8 o'clock. And say, well, my son is waking up at 8:50. Of course, when you sleep at 8, your son has the right to wake up at 8:50, isn't it? You don't wash your legs and you say, ah, you are very dead, my son. I mean, you have no right. Yeah. What right do you have? Yeah. You don't know your memory verse and you are blaming your son. Why don't you know your memory verse? What right do you have? It's a hypocrisy. So spiritual discipline will help you to move to the life of more than enough and stay there and enjoy it. What this spiritual discipline means, God definitely will let you know. But if you read from Hebrews chapter 12, you will see that our God is a disciplinarian. Our God is what? There's nobody who moved very close to God who was not disciplined. Nobody. Abraham was disciplined. Isaac was disciplined. Jacob was disciplined. Moses was disciplined. You can't move close to God and God will not discipline you. Why? Because you are human and he is God. And when you cross the line, he will show you you have crossed the line. It's not an evangelist matter. And yet, many of us think that God will condone you. God will condone you. Grace does not cover indiscipline. Amen? Grace may cover your sin, but it doesn't cover indiscipline. Because indiscipline could lead you back to sin. The word is enough for us. Okay, Hebrews chapter 12, I read verses verse 5 and 5 verses here. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despite not the chastening of the law, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. If the spirit of him that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is in you, that spirit will check your excesses. If the spirit that will raise him up and the last day is in you, whenever you cross the line. You are in we tell you, our prayer that may you cooperate.
Amen.
May you cooperate with him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, as budget ever every soul whom he respects. If you endure chastening, this thing, God delight with you as his sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if he be without chastisement, whereof are ye partakers, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we give them reference. Shall we not much rather be in subjection to the Father of the Spirit and live? For they remain for a few days to stand us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Verse 11. No chastening or discipline, for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous, however, but nevertheless, afterwards, it yields peaceable fruits of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Glory to God. So, that is the gospel. It contains the rod of Jonah, a testimony, an example of call for self-discipline. And we also saw it in the Act also that there are two cherubims that spread their wings like this face to face, and they are looking down on the wall. And these cherubims, they are angelic representation. And what they depict that our God is a consuming fire. He's a God of grace, but he's a God of judgment. He's a God of mercy, but he's not an indulgent father. Because love without deterrent is deceit. You say you love your child, and your child is going to touch fire. I love the child. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Is that what you do? When he's going to touch fire, you jump up, you beat the man. So why do you beat your child that is going to touch fire? Don't you love the child? You do. Love without deterrent is deceit. I love there must be something to show that if I do something contrary, there's repercussion for it. God is not an indulgent father. In Proverbs chapter 29, verse 5, say, he that is often building proved and hardens his neck. Surely he will destroy him. And that so it's important, therefore, for us to be a first learner. A first lesson learner. At least you get it right the first time. We call it quality management. Quality management means you get it right the first time. God is teaching a lesson. Get it right. Don't wait for repeat. Remember, there's no automatic promotion with God. You agree?
Yeah.
If he's teaching you a lesson about your time, you don't learn it. You double the punishment. And then you learn it. If teaching you about the lesson about giving, you don't learn it. You will learn it. You can't go on the learning. He's teaching you about a lesson about loving your friend or something like that, and you don't learn it. He's not going to promote you. So your promotion is hinged to you obeying what he has told you to do. So he's not an indulgent father. Therefore, learn your lesson, pass it first time. They didn't cross that Jordan two times. It was one time. And I pray that as you cross it, was a new decade of what I know. That crossing it only once.
Yes.
All your failure will not cross it.
Amen.
All your sickness will not cross it.
Amen.
All your lost opportunity will not cross it.
Amen.
As you cross, you are giving a new life.
Amen.
A new ticket.
Amen.
A new year.
Amen.
A year of more than enough. In Jesus Christ's name. So, the rod and the staff is after the taking. See that rod and the staff, they do what? They comfort you. Glory to God. But we also realize that in the ark is the mercy seat. The mercy seat is between the cherubim and the Lord. That's the grace. The grace is standing in between. So I want to be conscious of grace. Be more conscious of grace than disgrace. Amen. If God, if Jesus has saved you, you must be more conscious of grace than disgrace. If God has not saved you, of course, into the sin has been traveling. If it is night, we wish it for a day. If it is day, we wish for, if it is winter, we wish for summer. If it is summer, we wish for winter. But when God is, when you are born again, I want you to realize who you are. Amen?
Amen.
That you are the seed of Abraham by faith. And you are crossed over from the land of not enough to the land of more than enough. So grace is greater than your sin. And the blessing of God has been provided by grace. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3. Excuse me. All that you ever need from your childhood to your grave is available under the blood of Jesus. Say amen.
Amen.
God is not going to create a new planet to meet your need.
Yes.
Is he going to do that?
No.
Or is he going to create a new method to meet your need? No. All that you ever need from your gratitude to the grave, from your back to your death, is available. But they are in the spirit. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 6 says, he has blessed all spiritual in the heavenly places. They are in the heavenly places. But it takes your cooperation with the word of God to materialize them in the material, in the natural. When you obey the word of God, then they are transformed. They metamorphosize from spiritual to physical. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, just for us to go and read, you know, notice that they are going to pass the ark, they are going to pass through Jordan now. The ark of covenant was carried by how many people? Four priests. They carry the ark, and they are in front. The priests were consecrated. And we said the ark is a gospel. Who are the people who are carrying the gospel to be? Is it only the preachers? Is it only the singers? The gospel Bible today must be preached by all of us.
Amen.
I didn't hear you.
Amen.
All of us must be a team player in this gospel that is taking us to our land of promise. All of us must be a player. Don't be a spectator, because the spectator can either cheer or jeer. You know, they are very close words. Jeer will discourage. Racial comments. You know, they say in football, they say racial comment, they are discouraging people now. They cheer. But the cheer, they go, yeah, it's not there, they go. Because they just want to score. But for the player, he is focused on victory and victory alone. Amen. So, see your brother as a peer. The intercession is victory. You are going together. In front of them, they are going together and they move together in one direction. And I think you have seen the married people, well, the day of their marriage. I think you know how they marry. You have to see how they match. When they are playing the wedding match. See, what they do? Left together. You never see the husband going forward and the wife going backwards. No, it's okay. If it's... That is the end of money. For all of us, we need to cook in. It takes a single person to score the goal, but the team to win the match.
Amen.
You agree?
Yes.
A single person will score the goal, but the team will do what? Will win the match. Because if the scorer is there, you know, can he keep the goal? Can he play the back? No. So we're a team. So the gospel, we need a team of people. As we want to move to a land of more than enough. Come along with all. Join all. Join hands. Don't be a spectator. Don't complain about anything. Be among those who repair. Be a repairer of the bridge. Be a contributor to the progress. Not to those who discourage you by your comment, by what you will say. We need a team. A team will move all of us, and we are going to win the championship. Glory be to God. So the ark was carried by four consecrated priests. Be a team player in the gospel, and God can God depend upon you. Be a winner and help the others to be safe. And just finally, obedience is a bridge. Obedience is a bridge. After everything is ready, they are just waiting for the command. Go! And no one to give them the command. It was Joshua. Amen. One person to give them the command. Go! And when the church said, go! Everybody, including small, young, old, everybody, pregnant or what, they just have to move. That's obedience. We are praying that God will give you that obedience. The Bible says, when your obedience is complete, you will be able to resent every disobedience. You know what that means? When Satan disobeys the rule, you can discipline him. Amen? When your obedience is complete, when you are under authority, you can issue authority. You agree?
Yes.
I explain to you. A commander in the army or a commander in the police, can he go and command in the army barrack? Eh? When he goes and says, hey, pray, 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 they will not do it this one. But if when you are under authority, you can also do what issue authority. So when your obedience is complete, if God is telling you about the way you obey, about your financial discipline you obey, about your time discipline you obey, and then every time the devil crosses the line, he says, no, shut up, you must shut up. Hallelujah. Amen. I pray God will help you understand this. It's time for us to pray now. And I'm praying that God will help you to know that you have to pray. That now is the time to get saved, now is the time to get sanctified, now is the time to embrace the same gospel, now is the time to have complete obedience. If Jesus said you must be saved, you must be saved. If he says you need the Holy Ghost, don't excuse yourself. If he says you must pay your tithe, don't excuse yourself. Because if your obedience is not complete, you will issue obedience, it is all I know. Say that I know. But who are you? But that should not be our lot. It's time now for us to get ready to move into a life that is more than you. To move into the next year of our superabundance. To move into the next decade of success and prosperity. Would you like to pray?
Amen.
Let's go and pray. God bless you. Thank you.